students, today let's start with a new chapter of business studies, that is the forms of business organization, that is chapter 3, the final chapter of business studies, that is the forms of business organization. Before we start with the forms of business organization, tell me what is the meaning of business. In the previous chapter we have learnt about it, isn't it? What is the meaning of business? So business is an economic activity. Business is an economic activity which is mainly concerned with the production and distribution. Production, that is manufacturing of goods and services, and distribution of goods and services. Whom does it reach? Finally, the produced goods have to reach the consumers, and the businessman has to get the sufficient profit, and the cost should be covered with the profit. So, hope you have recalled the meaning of business today. What are we going to learn? That let's see. So, today we are going to learn about the forms of business organization. Organization, what is the meaning of organization? That is the meaning of, that is institution or organization. It's a business team or organization. So, today we are going to learn about the types of business organization. That means forms of business organization. What are the features, advantages, disadvantages of sole trading concern and the partnership firms? The Hindu undivided family business concern. So we are going to cover all these points. So today we are going to learn about the forms of business organization. So let's see what are the types or what are the various types which comes under the forms of business organization. So firstly, it's sole trading concern. Sole trading concern. Second one, partnership firm. Partnership firm. Third one, Hindu undivided family firms. The Hindu undivided family firms. Fourth one, cooperative society. Cooperative society. Fifth one, joint stock company. Joint stock company. So what are the various forms of business organization? It is the sole trading concern, partnership firm, Hindu undivided family firm, cooperative society, and the joint stock company. So today we are going to cover the privately owned firms, the privately owned business organization, that is the sole trading concern, the partnership firm, and the Hindu undivided family firm. The Hindu undivided family firm. Let's see the reader and discuss what are the meaning of these three organization or the business organization. Open your reader, my dear students, to page number 265. So let's read and discuss what is the meaning of these various business organization. So firstly, we are going to start with the sole trading concern. Sole is, what is the meaning of sole? Sole, alone. One person, one man show, or one man army, we say. Right? What is sole trading concern? Let's read it. It is run by a single person. This is run by a single person, one person. This business is owned by one single person. He is the owner and the manager. The one person who owns this kind of business is the only owner and the manager himself. He only owns, he only manages the decisions what is to be taken regarding the business. He only takes, understand? He enjoys all the profit and fully responsible for the losses. This statement, you have to tell me why. Why only he can enjoy the profit and only he can enjoy and cope up with the losses. Why? Because while beginning any business, you have to put capital. Capital is the first money what you use for investing on your business. That money you use for the, to run your business. So when he is the only person who invests in his company, he is the only eligible person who can enjoy the profit and face the loss. Nobody is going to come to face or earn or cope up his loss. Only he has to enjoy the profit. He can only earn the, cover the losses. He is the person who solely invests capital to run the business, as I told you. As he owns, he is the only person who owns and manages the business. He is the one who has to put the capital to run his business. So he is the only one who enjoys the profit and he only has to face the loss. So hope you have understood the meaning of sole trading concern. So let's see, let's discuss about the features of this kind of business organization. It is one of the oldest and simplest form of business. So have you seen the shopkeepers over here? That also you can call the sole trading concern, because he is the one who invests in his business, he is the one who owns, he is the one who manages the business. Understand? So this is one of the oldest and the simplest form. There is no legal formalities to be done in this kind of business. It is owned and managed by the single person, right? Okay. It is easy to start this kind of business, as there is no legal formalities, or you know, registration is not to be done, nothing, no legal procedures are there. This is very easy to start up. These concerns are run by sole traders for profit. This kind of business, does this, or who continues, or who invests on this? The sole trader, right? The one person who has invested, he runs this business for what? To earn profit. Whatever the capital he has put, or whatever the money he has to get some returns on it, right? The profit what he has to get. So that's why he runs this business. The sole trader uses his own skill and responsible for the losses. He is the only person who gives, he uses his own ideas, right? He doesn't take ideas from anybody. He is the one who decides, he is the one who faces all kind of troubles what he has in his business. He is the one to come over that trouble. He is the one who decides. So he is the one who is, you know, giving ideas and the tactics what he has to use to come over the losses. All those things are decided by that person, sole trader. Understand? So he is only responsible for all the losses what he faces in his business, because he is the one who decides, right? Sole trader takes the help of his family members or appoints some workers to help in business. He can work, he can make somebody work under him. He can take his family help. The members who are in his family, they can work in his shop or business. Generally, they are small in size. The investment is small, capital is small. Understand? But nowadays, they run a big scale also. Some, this sole trading concern, actually the concept is, the business is run with the minimal capital, minimal profit. Even the loss will be, bearable. That kind of business, this concept actually is. But these days, people have more money. The sole trading concern also, they do it in a large scale. They organize or they start it with the large scale. Understand? Okay, now we'll see the advantages of sole trading concern. So the first point is, no legal formalities are required to commence the business. As I've told you, there are no legal requirements, right? There are no legal formalities or requirements to commence the business. Why? Because this kind of business doesn't have any separate law. Okay, while commencing, there is no separate law like other, joint stock company. There are many formalities to be followed. Here, there is no separate law while commencing or the beginning of the business. It can be started by own capital. Now, if you have some 1 lakh or 1.5 lakh, 2 lakh, you can start your own business until you are some kind of age, matured age, until you are 18 or that particular your major, or you have turned majority. So you can start up your own business, right? You can start up your own business. You can start with the own capital. You know why I'm mentioning this? You'll get to know when I teach you the next concept. Partnership are done with two or more people. Okay, so sole trading is done by one person. That's why that can be started by own capital. No difficulties arise in day-to-day running of the business. Because why there is no, problems? Because the decisions have been taken by the sole trader, the one person who runs or owns the or manages the business. He only decides. Even if he doesn't do anything that particular day, nobody is going to ask. No difficulties for him, right? No difficulties arise in day-to-day running business, because the concept or the accounts, whatever he is being seeing, that he himself is seeing. He needn't rely or depend on somebody. So there is no trouble or difficulties in running of the business or day-to-day running of the business. The owner enjoys all the profits and bears all the losses. They directly come into contact with the consumers, right? As I've given you the normal example of the shopkeepers who are here, the one who have owned the shop, they are the sole trader. So they have direct contact with the consumers. Who has direct contact with the consumer? The sole traders. they have direct contact with the customers. The customers can go directly to that particular shop and buy things. They render some social services also. They provide employment to some people. They provide employment to some people as in, if you are owning a business, a sole trading business. So in case you can't manage it by yourself, like, you know, selling of the things, you can make some people work under you. You can appoint some people to work under you, right? So they provide, such kind of businesses provide the employment opportunity as well. They help in distribution of the wealth. They help in distribution of the wealth. They understand the likes and dislikes of the consumers. How do they understand the likes and dislikes of the consumers? Why? Because they have direct contact with the consumers. They have direct touch with the consumers. So they know what are the likes and dislikes of the consumers. They supply goods accordingly, pay rates, taxes, duties to the government. Sole trading concerns from their profits, the duty what they have to do, paying of the rates and taxes to the government, they do it. They are in position to take quick decision regarding business because it's a sole trading concern. He needn't depend on or wait for somebody else to take decision regarding his business. So he is the one who can, he relies on himself regarding the decisions. When he has to take quick decisions, it's him who takes the decision. They maintain business secrets. When it's your business, your account, whatever you are doing, you know, you needn't discuss with anybody. So secrets, business secrecy is, you know, it's maintained. Okay. Next we'll see disadvantages of the sole trading concern. What might be the disadvantages? We have discussed about the features, advantages. What might be the disadvantages? See, he is the only person. He's the only person who manages the business. It becomes very difficult for him, isn't it? He is the only person who is responsible for anything in case of the losses, right? In here, if I give you partnership form example, two or more people will be there, capital also will be more put by two or more people, profits also will be shared accordingly, losses also will be shared accordingly. So there is no much responsibility on one person here. Here what happens in sole trading concern? Entire responsibility is on the sole trader. So let's see what are the disadvantages of the sole trading concern. Capital is limited. See, I told you, capital is limited because he is the only person who invests on his business. He doesn't get it from somebody else except the, you know, financial institutions like banks or something. He doesn't get help from partners in case he doesn't have, because he's a sole trading concern. Like compared to this partnership firm, he doesn't have any help from anybody else. So capital is limited, that's why it becomes difficult for him to expand or extend his business, right? He has very limited capital, so when he invests on his own business, he has to wait for years to get more number of profit so that he can expand. It takes time. Okay, so the capital is limited, that's why he cannot expand the business in near future. Since it's run by single person and managerial ability is limited, group decision are always better and effective. See students, when you have to decide something regarding any important thing, when you take the responsibility, a huge responsibility, when you have to take the decision, it becomes very stressful for you in case something goes wrong or it will be troublesome for you in the future. So what do? You go for somebody whom you can count upon or you can rely upon. You can go to some elder people or your teachers or your, you know, HM or your parents themselves. You can go and ask for them what to do, right? That's why when there is discussion amidst the people, you'll get better or effective ideas. So here what happens is, the single person runs the business, so managerial ability will be little limited because he has to stick to his own ability. He can't ask for the ideas or he can't depend on somebody for the ideas or the decision to be taken. So the managerial ability is limited. All the losses have been borne by the single person because he's the one who invests on the company. The business organization. He's the one who invests on the business organization. He's the one who puts capital. He's the one who, you know, enjoys the profit. Only one person. So he's the one who borne the losses as well. Life of the sole trading concerns may be short with the death or resolution of the sole trader. The trading concerns will be closed. they say that sole trading concerns life of the business organization is shorter because he is the only one person who manages or owns the business, right? There are no partners. He's the only one person. In case of his ill health, if he loses his life, then that organization will shut down or close. Okay. So, in case of the death or in case he faces a lot of losses, we call it solvency. So, in case of the a lot of losses, he can't bear more loss, then he has to shut down the concerns. He can't take anybody's help. This is not partnership form. This is sole trading concern. So, he has to depend on his own ability, own ideas, own capital, own money. That's why this the life of this kind of concern is shorter. Now, let's see the second type of the forms of business organization. So, now let's discuss about the second type of business organization, that is the partnership firms. The partnership firm. First one, what it was? It was the sole trading concern. The sole trading concern. So, while discussing about the partnership firms, we are at the same time going to compare about, in between the sole trading concern and the partnership firm. Whereas the sole trading concern was run, owned, and the and managed by a single person, right? Let's see what is the meaning of the partnership firms. The partnership firms. So, the limitations of the sole trading concern lead to the formations of the partnership firms. Means the limitations or the disadvantages of the sole trading concerns lead to the formation of partnership firms. That means because the sole trading concern is being dealt or managed by a single person, so the capital is also invested very less. So, when there is less amount of capital, when you are not able to form that level of business what you actually want to start, then this leads to the partnership firms where you take help of other people, include them into your business, so you will have different partners. Those kind of businesses called as the partnership firms. Okay, so the limitations of sole trading concern lead to the formation of the partnership firms. In these firms, two or more persons join together to carry on the business. So, in this kind of businesses, there are two or more people involved. So, in this kind of business, there are two or more people involved or they carry on the business. Whereas, in the sole trading concern, only one person is to manage or own the business. So, these kind of business have been carried on by two or more people. The Partnership Firms Act was passed in the year 1932. When was the Partnership Firms Act was passed? The Partnership Firms Act was passed in the year 1932. According to the Section 4 of Partnership Act, what is partnership firm? Let's see now. The relation between the persons, who have agreed to share the profits of the business. That means when you share the profit, you have to invest something, right? You have to invest in the company as well. Only then you can enjoy the profits of the business, which is carried on by all. The all means here, all means the people who are participating in this kind of business, or any one of them, acting for all the people who are into the business. So let's reread what is it. So what is partnership act? What is partnership firm? So according to the Section 4 of Partnership Act, partnership firm means the relation between the persons who have agreed to share the profits of the business. Of course, in loss they have to share. According to the what kind of business it is carried on by all the people who are participating in it, or any one of them acting for all. So you might think what is partner? Partner is the one who shares your business or whatever it is. For husband or wife you call life partners, right? The one who accompanies you, the one who walks with you, or leads with you. So there are various type of partners here. So what are the type of partners? Let's discuss. So in this kind of business, there are different partners who perform or participate with the company. So they are the active partners. Active partners, as the name itself says, the one who is working, the one who is working very actively. So active partners, who is also called as the working partners. Next is sleeping partners. third is nominal partners, and the last one is the minor partners. So you tell me the various type of partners. They are the active or the working partners, the sleeping partners, the nominal partners, and the minor partners. So let's see what are these or the meaning of these kind of partners. Active partners. They contribute fixed amount of capital. They have a fixed amount of capital what they are going to contribute. Share the profits or losses in proportion, maybe 2:3, or you know, in such ratios they have the fixed ratio. According to that they will be, you know, enjoying profits and bearing the losses as well, and to their capital contributions as well, and take active part in carrying on day-to-day affairs of the business. So these people are very active in the participation of business, where they have sufficient or, you know, exact fixed rate of capital contribution and enjoying the profit and, you know, bearing the loss. They have particular proportion of, you know, these things like profit and losses. So hope you have understood the meaning of active partners. Active partners are the working partners who participate actively in the day-to-day business affairs. Second is sleeping partners. What is sleeping partners? Let's see now. They contribute capital but do not take active part in day-to-day business. They contribute money, they contribute capital for running down the, you know, running of the business. What does the businessman want? Money to invest, right? So that thing is, you know, the sleeping partners contribute capital, but they do not come to the business firm, or they do not participate in day-to-day affairs of the business or day-to-day transaction of the firm. Transaction means, you know, when the money comes and goes, buying and selling, that is also called as a transaction. The profits and losses are shared in the proportion of their capital contribution. The amount of the, you know, what contribution is done by them, what proportion it is contributed, the same equal contribution will be, you know, given back to them. If they have given more capital, then they'll get more profit. And equal amount of losses, if they have contributed less, that amount, that proportion of profit they are going to get, and that fixed amount of losses they have to bear or suffer. So third type of partner is nominal partners. Nominal partners, they neither contribute capital or they are part, you know, participating in this kind of business firms actively. So here what have they said? Nominal partners, they do not, you know, contribute any capital. No capital has been contributed by them. No money has been invested by them. They don't take any active participation. So we have got 2 points here. They do not contribute capital. They do not take active participation in day-to-day transactions of the business firms or affairs of the business. They are not entitled for sharing any profit. No profit also has been given to this kind of partners. So 3 points. One is no contribution is done by them. No capital contribution. Then the second point is no active participation is done by them. Third one, no profit has been given to them. They are liable for business losses. Only losses have been borne by them. So these kind of partners are called as nominal partners. Minor partners. So the fourth point is minor partners. Active partners, sleeping partners, nominal, we have understood, right? Now let's see the minor partners. As the name itself says, the one who is lesser, you know, younger in the age, younger than 18, the one who is not yet adult, the one who has not attained the age of 18. These partners are those who have not attained the age of 18, younger than the age of 18 years, lesser, I put minus here, okay. So lesser than the, he has not attained the age of 18. A minor cannot become a partner. He has no right to become a partner as he has not attained the age of 18, but the mutual agreement of the partners, a minor can be admitted as a partner. He can be admitted as a partner, but he cannot take active participation in the business. The minor partners are eligible for profits but not eligible for the defaults or the losses. They are entitled to enjoy the profits, but they do not have any defaults, or they can't bear any losses as they have not attained the age of 18. When a new partnership is started, the minor cannot be admitted. When the new business is being started or new partnership firms have been commenced or begun or started, minor partners are not eligible for the admission. They are not allowed to have the admission in the this kind of business. In addition to these types, there are secret partners, limited partners, and partners eligible for only profit. In spite or apart from these four partnership, that is partners, active partners, T2 partners, nominal or minor, there are other partners as well who are secret partners, limited partners, and the partners eligible for only profit, where these nominal partners are eligible for only losses. So there are some partners who are eligible for only profits. So now let's see what is the meaning of partnership deed. Have you heard about it? Partnership deed. Deed is like a deal. A deed. Okay. So what is partnership deed? We'll see now. There shall be a deed of partnership. There shall be always deal of partnership. Generally, it is in writing. So generally, this partnership deed will be in writing, duly stamped and signed by all the partners. That to this kind of deal, all the partners are agreeing. So for to clarify this or to have a good clarity, this deed is being formed. Okay, so this is generally in writing. They are duly stamped and been taken signature of all the partners. It contains all the terms and conditions. What does this partnership deed contain? It contains the terms and conditions, that means rules and regulations. Okay, terms and conditions. What are the conditions to carry on the business? Everything has been there. Only when the partners agree, they are going to sign. That is the indication that all the partners are agreeing for these terms and conditions. So to clarify that, this deed is been done. So what is there in this deed? Let's see. It contains the name of the firm. Okay, about the firm. It contains the name of the firm. Then what does it contain? Names and addresses of the partners. Names and addresses of the partners. Then what does it contain? The address of the firm. So the address of the firm. Then nature of the business, what kind of business it is. Nature of the business. Okay. Nature of the business is being written in that. Address of the branches, if any. In case in Kakala you have one branch, and in Kundapur or Magalur you have another branch, names of the branches also have been written. Mention the branches. Okay. If you have expanded your business in other places, like that. And commencement, contribution of the capital, date of commencement, contributions, what ratio the partners contribute their capital and suffer losses or bear losses or enjoys profit. Everything has been written in this kind of deed. Sharing profits, duties of each partner, division of work, conditions to be followed at the time of admission of the new partner, valuation of the goods will be during the time of admission of the partner, time of closing the business, procedures to be followed whenever differences arise among the partners. So in case anybody has any problem, they have to go through these terms and conditions. In case they don't follow these terms and conditions, one is eligible to dissolve the business. Understand? So what is mentioned in this kind of deed? In this deed, there is name of the firm, names and addresses of the partners, the address of the firm, the address of that particular firm, that particular branch where that owner is there, then the nature of business, addresses of the branches in case you have it in other places, about that also, date of commencement of the business, when was it started, when the business started, that also should be mentioned, addresses over, then contributions of the capital done by the each partner. You have different partner, imagine you have different partner in the business, so about that also you got to write. Then admission of the new partner, about the admission and valuation of the goods, what is the valuation or the amount of the goods to be during the admission of the partner, time of closing of the business, in case the company has been started for only 2 years, on what date should the company be closed, about that it is mentioned. And partnership firms, the maximum number of partners is fixed here. Okay, in partnership firms, the maximum number of the partners' participation is fixed. As in, maximum number of partners is fixed to 10 if they carry out banking business. For banking business, the number of partners' participation is fixed to 10. Only 10 people can be partners in the banking business. In case of general business, then the limitation of the partners' participation is 20. General business, then the limitation of the partners' participation is 20. In case of the banking businesses, then the participation of the partners is just limited to 10. So, hope this concept is clear to you. Now, let's discuss about the advantages of partnership firm. What might be the advantages, as we know, when we compare between sole trading concern and the partnership firm? Of course, we will get ample of advantages. A simple way, okay, sole trading concern, you have fixed amount of capital, whereas in partnership firm, you have many people to contribute capital here. So, this first point is easy to form. There are no legal formalities what are required to formation of the business organization. They have this partnership deed where they have all the information. Even the registration of the partnership is not compulsory. See, a partnership firm, it's good to have registration. In case when the third party interferes, in your business, you can file a case against that. But if your company is or the firm is not registered, then it will be very difficult for you to, you know, cope up with the situation. Okay, more capital. As you know, second point is more capital means, in sole trading concern, you have only one person who owns and manages the business, whereas in partnership firm, there are many people to contribute the capital. Better efficiency, because in sole trading concern, there is only one person, his efficiency becomes lesser, he gets tired day by day, he can't take ideas from others, but whereas in partnership firm, there are many people to show their efficiency, to participate, to decide, to perform, there are many people. So even division of labor becomes easy here. In sole trading concern, only one person has to work a lot, whereas in partnership firm, the division of labor is, you know, becomes easier to divide the job properly and have good efficiency in the workplace. Credit worthiness. What is the meaning of credit worthiness? The liability of partners is unlimited. Okay, what is the meaning of liability? What is the meaning of liability? Students, liability means a state of being responsible for something. Okay, so these partners are responsible for everything regarding the business. Unlimited it is. Liability is unlimited. The state of being responsible for something. So it leads to increase in credit worthiness. Sharing of business losses, as there are many people, whereas in sole trading concern only one person had to bear a lot amount of losses in case he had, but whereas in partnership firm, what happens, there are many people to, you know, contribute or bear the loss, so the burden of one particular or each people becomes lesser. Secrecy of business, as the, you know, secrecy actually in sole trading concern, secrecy is maintained well, whereas in the partnership firm, secrecy, what happens in case one is one is not efficient or betrays the partnership firm or the company, he can leak the secrets to others, or else it is fine, but the partnership firms need not publish their accounts, whereas joint stock company, the fifth type of business organization, they have to publish their statements or the business accounts to the public, because the public funds have been taken in joint stock companies. That we will learn in next concept. Okay, in joint stock companies, they take public funds, so they have to publish their account statement to the public, whereas in partnership firms, they needn't publish anything relating to their business accounts. Clear? Okay. Simple dissolution. Dissolution means shutting down. Simple, there is no procedure. Whereas, because the starting, commencement of the business is easy, that's why the dissolution also becomes easier for them. Partnership firms can be dissolved easily without any, any partner can apply for the dissolution by just giving 14 days notice, and with the consent of all other partners, the company can dissolve. Clear? Hope this merits, you are understood. Now, tell me, what are the disadvantages or the demerits of the partnership firm? Let's see. Sometimes the disunity among the partners, what happens, one is not, you know, agreeing for the ideas what have been given by others, that becomes difficult because everybody has to have consent or everybody has to agree for, you know, putting forward some idea. When the two people or a single person is not agreeing with the idea, it becomes difficult to cope up with the situation. Since the number of partners is limited, the capital contribution also becomes limited. But it's way better than the sole trading concern. But compared to sole trading concern, partnership firms have good amount of capital. But compared to joint stock company, these are very limited. Okay, so there is limited capital contribution here. Liability is also unlimited. So it discourages many people to join the partners because the responsibility is too much. They can't depend on other people. The people who are in the participation of the business, only they have to bond they have to be responsible for all everything relating to the business. So reckless and foolish decisions of some partners can lead to heavy setbacks. In case the partners are not efficient regarding some ideas regarding business, so what happens? They have to suffer huge amount of losses. So reckless and foolish decisions can lead to heavy troubles. Partnership firms lack continuity. The death or insolvency of one or the, in case the efficient partner dies or insolvency happens, if he doesn't have much money to contribute or something like that, then the company can come down or shut it down. It is difficult to transfer the shares to the share of the partners to the others. Owing to lack of control by the government, publishing of the account, partnership firms cannot gain public support. As they have no public, you know, they don't take public funds. They can't take public funds because in case they take public funds, they have to publish their account. So this becomes, you know, they don't gain much public support because of this. The secrecy of the business cannot be maintained since there are two or more number of partners. So what happens when compared to sole trading concern? Sole trading concern, the one person who owns and manages, right? So secrecy will be maintained very well. So when it compared to partnership firm, there are two or more number of people. In case one person leaks the information, then it can be, you know, it can result in the disaster. It can result in the trouble of coming over a business. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of partnership firm. Make sure you read your reader well so that you understand the concept more.